west. All right? Now, landforms were significantly changed by the recent advance of the glacial ice age.
I like it.
Yay!
And I'll never forget, Andy, she came in the door and she said, I'm not even going to try and look for it.
Storm toppled hundreds of huge trees.
Well, Andy, it's a long story.
Andy, this smells so good.
Well, hello, everyone. And you know, one of the reasons I love doing this show is there is always a great story to tell. There are new discoveries awaiting. My name is Andy Asher. I am host of Let's Talk Food Travel Live Squared. It's going on 12 years now since launching my passion project about living well after 55 that grew into this show. It was shortly after I retired, I started this journey inspired by my dad when he reinvented himself to focus on helping older people build a better life after 55. And he used his skills as a medical doctor. For me, it's about my messaging skills in digital media. Now, his inspiration helped me build one of the largest digital platforms for people over 55. With a name that became a meaningful mouthful, bloomerboomer.com, it continues its growth with the launch in 2023 of this weekly program, Let's Talk Food Travel Live Squared. And Live Squared describes our two-part reality. The show is live streamed on platforms everywhere, and we live by a code to live life authentically. And it is one of the greatest pleasures in life about getting older. I want to thank you for your support. At the end of today's show, I will tell you three ways that you can keep the show growing. So, let's get on with today's program. Talk about a moment in the spotlight for baby boomers. Two women winning top awards at this year's Oscars are 60-year-old Michelle Yeoh, making history with Best Actress Award, and 64-year-old Jamie Lee Curtis winning for Best Supporting Actress.
The Oscar goes to Michelle Yeoh.
As a child, Michelle Yeoh studied to become a ballet dancer, and despite her illustrious career in action films, has no formal training in martial arts.
Thank you.
Here is a fun fact. Everyone who won an acting Oscar on Sunday night was over the age of 50. I watched Everything Everywhere All at Once. Parts I enjoyed, others left me kind of scratching my head, and I'm still trying to process it all. I know one thing, a second screening is a must. It was fun to watch, even though I was lost much of the time. And congratulations to those fine ladies, Michelle and Jamie Lee. And speaking of fine ladies, let's check in with Mimi in the kitchen, because she is, in my humble opinion, one of the best Mediterranean cooks to be found anywhere. Mimi?
Hello. Hello, hello. How are you guys doing? So today I'm going to make some prawns. All right, so after I clean them, divine them, I have prepared some spices here, which are paprika, cayenne pepper, garlic powder, dried oregano, dried parsley. And I'm just gonna marinate this with olive oil. I put a little bit of olive oil in there, like that. And then just mix everything up. That's a nice color. Paprika, cayenne pepper, oregano, parsley, and then of course, don't forget the kosher salt. Don't put a lot of salt, just a little, because you're gonna see why later. And then some fresh ground pepper, black pepper. All right. So while this is marinating, I'm gonna start cutting my spinach, my garlic, my tomatoes, and then come back to show you how I cook it. I'll see you later.
Thanks, Mimi. We'll be right back. Meantime, today's interview segment is about addictions, a treatable, chronic, medical disease involving complex interactions among the brain, the circuits, genetics, the environment. You know, with other people's addictions, sometimes you really never know when someone is hooked, because they mask it so well, what I call a functional addict. It's one of those feelings that you never know for sure, just something is wrong. Well, today's guest is one of those people, in my opinion, a high-functioning, double major graduate from a prestigious university and a high-level business executive, although his private life crumbled. He is Jack Levine, who has become an evangelist about the quest to help addicts. Jack, thanks for being here. And now the first question I almost always ask is your origin story.
Sure. So I was brought up with very middle-class loving parents. I had an older brother and had a very normal childhood. I wore a baseball cap till I was 16, started smoking pot at 16 years old, and through high school. And then when I went to college, to Syracuse University, I started to do harder stuff. I got into Quaaludes and Percocet, and eventually, at the end of my college career, cocaine. I was still very high functioning. I graduated with 2 degrees from Syracuse in advertising and sociology, went to work on Madison Avenue, which was a dream for me. I wanted to play baseball for the Yankees, but that didn't happen. So yeah. Madison Avenue is the next best thing. And again, very high functioning, but my drug use was really starting to take over and control me. I was able to function, but I knew spiritually and emotionally I was bankrupt. I really felt like I was in the pit of hell, that I was like an animal trapped in a trap. And moved down to Florida to try to get away from my addiction, left Madison Avenue hoping that it wouldn't follow me down, but it did. And it took me quite some time, but Percocet and cocaine were really, the destruction of me, the end. And it took me till 36 years old to give up my addiction and to finally go for the help I needed. And I always, knew the first year or two was great of using drugs, really. I mean, it's a lot of fun. And then a year or two in, it really becomes the enemy. It's like a kidnap victim, here's the candy, come on into the truck, and then it's gotcha. And it's just devastating. So I'm very glad it's been decades since I've seen the light and have been sober. And, God has used me to hopefully help other people along the way. But it's something I wouldn't wish on my worst enemy. I really would.
What was it like for you back in the time working in corporate America under the cloud of an addiction, or for you and maybe for your coworkers?
Yeah, and for me, same time, Andy. I graduated college in 79, so I was on Madison Avenue by 1980. Drugs were very widespread available in the office, everywhere, part of the social scene. And Andy, the interesting part is, like, the drugs themselves are not the problem. There are people who can recreationally use marijuana or take medicine as prescribed. One time during my course of my rehab, I said to my counselor, I said, well, what happens if I hurt my back? I had a back surgery, many years before. And I said, and I need to take, painkillers again. And he looked at me and he laughed and he said, your problem was never taking medicine as prescribed.
I see.
But it was very prevalent, even more so today. It's mind-boggling to me. I have 3 kids. My youngest are 18 and 20. Unfortunately, my 20-year-old could pick up his phone and have drugs delivered to the house if he wanted to. They are everywhere. And today, we're dealing with fentanyl and laced drugs and drugs that look like prescription drugs and laced in marijuana. People are dying, literally playing Russian roulette. I mean, that used to be the heroin user. You read an overdose, and heroin was never my drug of choice, and I couldn't stick a needle in my arm, but that's how people overdose for the most part. Now, it's guys who, thought they were taking a Percocet or smoking a joint or a line of cocaine, and they are dead 30 minutes later.
What I have firmly learned to believe is that you cannot help an addict until they're ready to be helped. Now, am I right on that? And how do you address that problem?
Well, technically, yes. I mean, without a doubt, you know, until they're ready, it doesn't matter what you tell them. But I think information is key. What I've learned in sharing with people is not everybody is ready to put down the drugs. You know, maybe they haven't hit a bottom yet. Maybe they haven't felt enough pain. But when I tell them what's going to happen, when I tell them where the addiction is going to lead them and take them through in the steps, and they start to recognize it, then perhaps along the way, they'll say, hey, you know, Jack was right about steps 1 and 2. Maybe he's right about 3, 4, and 5. Maybe I don't want to wind up in jail or dead or just life ruined. I mean, 1 out of every 8 people is an addict. So it's effective. Everybody across America. It's crushing the hopes, dreams, and futures of families and kids. It's ripping families apart. I can't tell you, Andy, how many spouses and parents I talk to who say to me, I can't be happy until my child or my husband or my wife is off drugs. And I talk to them and I say, listen, you know, your happiness can't be dependent upon their sobriety. I mean, I hope they get sober. We're going to give them the tools to get sober, but they have to choose it. But, you know, we can't let the enemy take down the whole family, you know, because of one person's drug use. It's a tragic thing. And, you know, my older kids struggle with drug use and addiction, and I get it for as an addict and as a parent.
But what kind of a message do you give to the vast age group in dealing with that?
I get right to the core. The key is, why do you use drugs? And all the time, it's to escape something, escape some reality, escape some thought. All of us addicts have feeling of low self-esteem, low self-worth, less than, not worthy, even type A high-functioning guys. I mean, this is the addiction. So the addiction is our escape. So what are we escaping from? Usually, Andy, it was something that happened in childhood. For some of us, it was very traumatic. There could have been abuse, physical or verbal, and you could understand why somebody would look to escape that pain. For a lot of us, it was very subtle things. Our minds built up defense mechanisms as little babies to help us stop feeling pain. But sometimes we don't take those things off, like a kid driving using tricycle, three-wheeler. That's good as a little kid, but not at 20, 30, 40 years old. Diapers are great for a baby, but not at 20, 30, 40 years old. So in counseling, we learn to examine what we were really trying to run from and escape. Sometimes it's something very minimal, like in my case, there was no trauma or abuse, but I was able to say, okay, I see this now. Thank you, young Jack, for trying to protect me, but I don't need this defense mechanism. I don't need these drugs or alcohol. You know, I'm ready to face the world, and the world is so much better. I mean, I can tell you, I wasted 12 years of my life doing, you know, drugs. It was a waste. Even though I functioned, it was a waste. Man, I can't even imagine what I could have done with those years back.
Well, you were a high achiever. I mean, you didn't waste all that time.
I achieved high, but spiritually and inside, you know, I can't even imagine what I could have done if I wasn't under the influence and hadn't been held back and by that. So, you know, thankfully, like I said, God has used that to allow me to help other people, and I'm grateful for it. I don't think it was God's choice I make bad decisions to become a drug addict, but, you know, when I turn from it, good things happen. But we want to encourage people that there's hope, there's a way out, there's multiple ways out of addiction, but you have to choose one. And it kind of goes back to what you said, is the person ready? All we can do is tell them there's a way out if you want it. Do you want help? That's the only question I ever ask an addict. When somebody calls and gets me involved, I say, do you want help? If that's yes, here it is. You know, here's help. I would just give this example. If you told me today I want to go to New York, I'd say, great, there's a plane leaving, you know, you can be there in 5 hours. Say, I won't fly. Will you take Amtrak? No, Greyhound. Will you hitchhike? Will you walk? Will you go horseback? You know, there's a lot of ways to get to New York, some of them more efficient and effective than others. All of them will get you there. So if you won't take any of them, what you're really saying is, I don't want to go to New York. So if you're not ready for help, it doesn't matter, you know, the path out that we lay out for you, you have to choose one.
Well, you're a young whippersnapper. I know you're a lot younger than me, but so as a young guy, what are you going to tell the older folks like me who, first of all, you're probably become the expert on this. What is the level of addiction and similar problems in the older over 55 generation?
Sure, and I would tell us I am over 55. I'll admit to that only.
You look great.
I'm in the club. I would say this. First of all, it's never too late It's never too late. Don't have this attitude of, oh, you know, I've done this all my life. If I could just go back and be 18 again. Let's look at that 18-year-old kid. He's got everything. His father's rich. He's going to give him the family business. He's good looking. He dies tomorrow in a car crash and you live 40 more years. It's not too late to change your life and do the right thing. And I would say it's very simple to tell if you have a problem or not. Can you stop? My challenge is, hey, I'll believe you're not addicted. Put that drug down or alcohol down for 30 days. And Andy, it's not about quantity and it's not about which drug. The person who tells me I take, you know, a couple of drinks every night to unwind is as addicted as the guy who binge drinks. We've learned that we're all in the same place spiritually and emotionally, regardless of how much or which drug we use. And yes, alcohol is a drug. To medicate ourselves, to numb ourselves, to get out of the pain. I get it. I did it. I understand. And addiction is a lie. Here's the great lie of addiction. It says to you, the addict, I'm your only friend. I understand you. Come, we'll be together. Your wife's hammering you. Your husband's hammering you. Your boss hammering you. Look at all this pressure society's putting you to perform. These people don't understand. Only I understand. And that's the great lie of addiction, you know, that it's your friend when in essence it is destroying you physically, financially, spiritually, and relationally and emotionally.
Well, you kind of already answered this question, but I want to ask it maybe a little bit differently. Do you think certain personality types lend themselves to addictions? High achievers?
I don't think it's just that. There is some genetic disposition, but only by about 15% more. I've seen, you know, people who are quiet and withdrawn and have major problems. People like myself who are certainly type A and outgoing, major problems. I don't think one leads to the other, but I think you'll know if you have an addictive personality. Like, I've always been either I'm all in or I'm all out. So for me, getting addicted to something is easy. Hopefully I can focus on good things now, but that is my nature. But it's really, you know, the addiction rewires your brain. First it comes in and captures you, then it rewires your brain so that you will lie, cheat, and steal to get drugs, do anything you can. And that sweet person, I always tell parents and spouses, that sweet boy, that husband, they're in there. They've just, you know, they're captured now. They've been rewired by the addiction, and it is cunning, and it is, you know, a progressive disease, meaning you could stop and pick up a year later and you'll be worse than you were a year ago. And that is the truth. I mean, it's medical facts.
You feel that there is something related to personality types and addiction?
And really, that answer is no. There's a 15% chance, because if you're genetically disposed, your parents, that more likely to use. But I've seen it in type A personalities like myself, in quiet people. That addiction literally rewires your brain. And in the Addiction Recovery Handbook, we're going to give a free ebook copy to anybody that wants it that's viewing. Dr. Adam Bianchini writes a chapter, he's a medical doctor, and talks about how your brain gets rewired. It's amazing. So when you have a flu, you know you have the symptoms of the flu. I mean, you got it. When you're addicted, the same thing happens. That addiction has rewired your brain. It becomes the priority of your life. It's very devious, very progressive. You know, you could stop for 6 months, pick up, and you're worse than before. And it just waits for its chance. You get caught, you get busted by your parents, by your spouse. Even if they send you to rehab or you're court ordered, but you weren't ready, that addiction will just wait its time. It's just waiting to come back, take control again, and literally rewires your brain. So no, it doesn't matter what personality type you are, unfortunately.
And this may be a question for a doctor or something, but yeah. Do you see people over 55 who have not been addicted before get addicted to drugs?
Yes. Now the doctor can answer differently, but usually what you'll hear is, I had an operation, I had pain, I hurt my shoulder, I went on painkillers, and I got addicted. They never planned it. They weren't even drug people. It's not like they were partiers in the 70s and, you know, looked for something else. No, they just, you know, got addicted. And it is highly addictive. There's no question. All of it, the marijuana that the kids are smoking today is 10 to 30 times more powerful than what we smoked in college. I'm looking at my 20-year-old son, who I'm not very happy that he's experimenting with marijuana, but he is. And that's the fact that his mother hasn't had a drink in 30 years, and I'm a recovering addict. So it just shows you the insanity of somebody's brain. And I'm looking at this stuff and I'm going, oh my gosh, how do you smoke this? You know, we smoked some Hawaiian or Thai stick in our day and we were knocked out for 2 days. The regular stuff, you know, we were smoking. This stuff is high potency, and they build up a tolerance. And, you know, these kids, they're starting to smoke pot at 10, 11, and 12 years old. Their brains aren't even developed. It is horrific what is happening. And the availability is just horrific. It's everywhere.
You know, in that story, you related about people who have an operation or in the back or something like that, and they get their first experience with, fentanyl or something. And, I mean, they might be the purest person in the world, but tell you that fentanyl was something great.
Well, and also, Andy, a lot of us at 55 years old and over are in pain. You know, our bodies are, you know, there's pain. Medical marijuana, it's legal now. Should I do that? Well, you can. Alcohol was legal too. And you know, but being drunk is not a great way to live your life. And it's going to cause more damage over time than it's going to help you for those 3 hours. So it's the same thing with drugs. I mean, again, as necessary, as prescribed, you know, for medical relief, of course. I had back surgery. You know, I think every doctor should have to have back pain to experience what it's like, because they would prescribe painkillers for their patients. You need them. When you need them, you should have them. But we're talking about, you know, now coming into an addictive state where you're depending on this substance to take your mind into a different place, because you're not satisfied with what it is, or who you are usually, or how the world is, or what's going to happen. And, you know, if we're 55 or older, a lot of these things have been with us all of our lives. Some we may not even know. We just think, this is the way I am. Well, really, we used to think the world was square. And then, you know, Columbus sailed, and now we have a new perspective. Now it's round. So I want to just suggest to our viewers that, you know, see for yourself, there's a new perspective. And you know, you can go to AA or NA, you can go into rehab, you can go to a long-term program, you can go to counseling. There's many different ways to get help, but take one of them. And listen, again, you know, the mindset of all this legalization in Oregon and Colorado of psychedelic mushrooms and all these other drugs, and, you know, they're everywhere. So it's never a question of availability or access. It's a question of how do you want to live your life? As somebody who lived in a drugged out, you know, functioning phase for 10 to 12 years, I can tell you these last 30 have been so much better. I love not being stoned. It's just fantastic. And, you know.
Yeah, well, now you've kind of given me a window into what you're going to say here, but are you in favor of changing our drug laws?
I'm concerned that young kids, you know, have access to drugs, and I think that's a big problem. It's not the drugs that are the problem. It's really not the drug laws. I'm not against legalized marijuana. Again, the drugs themselves are not the problem. It's the people, their attitude towards them, and how they use them. You know, I can walk by a bar and not order a drink. Alcohol is not a problem for me. I think if you gave me cocaine, I would turn it down today. And maybe 3 days and 5 days in a row. I don't know about day six and seven. So I don't want to be exposed to it too much. Yeah. But I really don't think, Andy, that it's the laws. I mean, as a person in society, I think that, you know, we should punish people who are selling drugs and killing our kids. Without a doubt, they need to, you know, have a problem. But that's not the issue. It's not tougher laws. There's always going to be access. There's always access to prostitution, whether you're in Nevada or not. There's access to drugs. There's access to illegal gambling. The question is, what are you going to do as an individual? And I would just say to somebody who's using drugs, you know you're miserable. You know you're addicted. I don't care if you don't let your friends tell you or your wife tell you. By the way, all your friends and wife, they know too. They might not say it to your face because you won't let them, but they know. And you know what's happening inside, whether you're functioning or not. You know that, you know, now I'm dependent on this, now I need it, and I don't even enjoy it anymore. I used to get, you know, greatly high. Now I just got a habit to get up. Mickey Mantle, that's a name most of us over 55 would remember, sure. Used to get up in the morning and drink a bottle of vodka to wake up. He had such high tolerance to his alcohol addiction to just stop shaking. He had to drink a bottle of vodka in the morning and drank throughout the day. You hear about, you know, people taking Percocet and thousands of dollars and hundreds of pills, and it doesn't matter. I only took 5 Percocets a day in the height of my drug addiction. I had new guys who took 200. I was as addicted and as hopeless as they were. It didn't matter the quantity. It didn't matter whether I was a binge drinker or every day. None of that mattered. What matters is you're addicted to something, and it is spiritually and emotionally, physically, relationally ruining your life, taking you you down, and it will destroy you. You know, it will destroy you one way or the other.
Would somebody say that you today are a different person than that guy back in that high-level job as an addict?
Thank God, yes. I absolutely want to say 100% yes. I was sitting in Lake Tahoe at a dinner with some friends of mine, and this is 20 years ago. I've been sober about 10 or 12 years, and I told a story from my drug dealing days in college. I'm not very proud of the fact that I sold pot as well, but I was sharing a story that I had $38,000 in a safe deposit box from selling drugs. You know, I was feeling pretty good about myself. And my friend's wife looks across the table at me, and she goes, "Why, Jack Levine, I would have never imagined that you would do something like that." I went up to my hotel room and I cried. And I thank God, I said, thank you, God, that people wouldn't even have thought that that's the person that I used to be. And life is so much better without the drugs. And I get it's a struggle. This is why detox, Andy, when you go to detox, I would have given up drugs, Percocet and cocaine, 2 years earlier if I knew how easy detox was. I was so scared of, you know, I knew I was hooked. So I was so scared of what was going to happen to me, you know, withdrawal detoxing. When I finally went to detox, it was a breeze. The drugs they gave me in detox were as good as what I was taking, except 4 or 5 days later, I was able to come off of them completely. And I wanted to get sober. And it was an easy transition. Had I known it was that easy, the detox process, that was just the beginning of the journey. But that was now your body is not physically craving the drugs anymore. And I'm like, this is great. And then it's a process. And I equated, Andy, to getting traded. I play for the Yankees. I go to Yankee Stadium. Now I get traded to the Red Sox. I don't put on a Yankee uniform anymore. I don't go to Yankee Stadium. Now I go to Fenway. It's a new life. Here's how you can tell if people are ready to get sober or not. If they embrace the recovery lifestyle, if they're fighting it, oh, I won't go to meetings. I don't want to do this. I want the old life. They haven't seen the light. They don't have a new perspective. When you see somebody, you'll know they're ready. They're embracing this new lifestyle. It's like when I moved to Florida or when I went to college, I knew I was in a new place. I didn't know what was going to happen, but I knew it was a new, exciting road. It's a journey. It's a lifelong journey, but it's so wonderful. It's so pure. There's so much real happiness and love to be found in the world, and so much, you know, validation and value to each individual as a person. And the drugs are lying to you and cheating you of your plans, hopes, futures, and dreams. And there is a way out. There's multiple ways out. Like we said, you know, I like rehab the best, the 30-day or 90-day rehab, because you can get off the hamster wheel of your life and really focus in therapy who you are and why, and understand why you do drugs. Then, if you choose to continue to do drugs, okay, that's an individual choice, but at least you'll understand why. For most of us, it's just that understanding that gives us the key to freedom.
As a family guy in your high-achieving job, how did it work? What was it like? Who knew what? What was a secret?
Well, it cost me my first marriage. I was married to a very sweet girl for about a year and a half. And, you know, I was in the height of my drug addiction. We thought we'd maybe have a baby to save the marriage. Fortunately, we did not. And one day I went on a cocaine binge again. I wasn't supposed to. I was supposed to try and get sober. And I'll never forget, Andy, she came in the door. And she said, I'm not even going to try and look for, you know, your stash, because I know you have secret stashes. And she got mad. She threw something at me and she said, "You're a loser and you'll always be a loser." And she stormed out the door. We got divorced. And 6 months later, you know, God kind of spoke to me and told me the divorce was my fault, that I really didn't love her as I should have. And I just said to God, "Listen, I'd love to, you know, be married and have a family. If you want me single, I'll stay single." This is about my faith journey. 6 years later, I waited 6 years. 6 years later, God brought Beth into my life. We've been married 22 years. I have 3 wonderful kids. Thank you, God. And the moral of the story is that, you know, It was painful. I caused pain to that first wife who didn't deserve what she got, because I hid myself. I had an image of myself I wanted her to believe. I wouldn't tell her how I was feeling. She was a sweet girl. She would have done anything for me. I could have opened up to her, but I wouldn't. And I learned the next time around. I said, no, I'm going to share who I am, flaws and faults and all. And this is a problem, you know, for addicts. We're trying to hide this stuff. And now I'm free. I mean, I've been free for 30 years. I'm free to be who I am, flaws and all. I don't have to hide anything. You know, I was prideful and egotistic. And you know, I believe I'm much more humble now. I believe that it's not about what people's perception of me is. It's about love. I've really come to the point where I'd rather be wrong and be loved. Like, I don't have to be right about everything anymore. Now, everybody thinks they're right when they say something. We all think we're right. But it's, I always think I'm right. But it's not about being right. I'd rather you be right. And you know, I'd rather have the friendship and love. And it's about people and connection and love. This is life. I believe that we're created to be connected, not alone. And the drugs isolate us. They separate us from the people who love us, from loving ourselves. They condemn us and make us feel crappy. We feel guilty because we know we're doing the wrong thing. We know we're not in line with God. We know we're not in line with other people. And it just takes us down step by step. Some drugs will take you faster than the other thing. And methamphetamine will destroy your life real quick. Alcohol a little slower. You know, fentanyl immediately. Percocet and speed a little slower. But they're all going to get you to the same place. But the good news is there's a way out. There's hope and a way out for anybody who wants it. So, you know, I would encourage people, find out your true self. You know, I know this is, we're not telling anybody what to believe spiritually. It's a very individual decision. But there's a great line in the Bible in Proverbs 19:8. It says, he who gets wisdom loves his own soul. And addicts don't love themselves. They're their own worst enemies. And we got to realize, you have kids, Andy?
Yes.
So you know how much you love your kids. You mm-hmm. would do anything for them. As a matter of fact, everything you do is in their best interest, whether they know it or not. Because you love them so much, you would die for any one of your kids. So, you know, regardless of where you stand spiritually, you know, I'm not the creator of the earth. You're not. We probably know it's not you and me. Somebody probably created it. And there's a God who loves you and wants you to feel loved and be loved. And just love created you like a snowflake, like an individual cake that he baked, and wants you to thrive as who you are. Not to compare yourself to other people. Just thrive and love and be who you are in this life. And addiction robs us of joy, laughter, love, fellowship, happiness, hopes, dreams, future. It's a thief stealing everything. And my advice would be, don't let it happen. You know, if you knew you're going to be robbed, you wouldn't stand there unarmed. You'd get your gun and you'd fight back and you'd call the sheriff. And, you know, we have the resources and tools for recovery. All that matters is, do you want help? And nobody is too far gone. Nobody is too far gone, no matter what, to turn around and be helped.
So live who you are. I hear that pretty much says live life authentically.
Yes. And happily and joyfully. I'm a Bruce Springsteen fan. So when I go to Bruce, and he's back on Twitter, and I've gone to hundreds of shows. When I go to a Bruce Springsteen concert, I don't sit there going, oh, I can't believe he's only going to play 3 hours. This sucks. It's going to be over in 3 hours. No, I'm like, this is so great. I don't care what song's coming next. Bruce, it's amazing. I'm so happy to be there just in the moment. Now, some people experience that with baseball and making love to your wife. And there's a lot of great things, eating pizza and hot chocolate. You know, but that's how we should feel about life. His life is a gift. We're here. Enjoy the ride. If I took you to Disney and I said the park's closing in an hour, you'd have a choice. You could either say, this sucks, I only have an hour, or let me in the car. I want to ride every ride in an hour. That's our lives. We have a choice, and we have to focus and take perspective.
And I don't want to shortchange your opportunity, because I know you have spoken about religion in connection to this, and you just did. Is there anything more that you would want to add to that?
Just that I believe God is real. I believe, you know, I have experienced God in my life for 30 years now. I believe there's a heaven and eternity. My only challenge to people, and I didn't believe that way for 33 years. So I wouldn't tell anybody, you got to think this or you got to think that. I can just tell you what I've experienced. My challenge is see for yourself. You know, test for yourself. There's a line in the Bible where Jesus says, ask and you shall receive, seek and you shall find, knock and the door shall be open. So he says, if you seek him, you'll find him. So if you go to seek him and he doesn't show up, you can prove he's a liar. So my challenge to people is open the book of John. It's a good place to start. Spend 30 days, 10 minutes a day seeking God's face. Ask him if he's real to reveal himself. And, you know, I've yet to meet the man that's come back and said, your God didn't show up. I've met many who won't go look. And Andy, I've seen many happy people who aren't Christian believers. I mean, it's very individual, have happy lives. I think there's a difference to eternity, to the Christian belief, that we won't get into now. But look, find your higher power. Find your higher power. For me, it's Jesus. There's no question. We could talk about that for years. And I was brought up Jewish and still am Jewish. But whatever it is, you know, you're not God. And you need to seek, you know, God, and God will reveal himself to you. And this is the key, you know, the love of the Lord. We have a last thing. I have a nephew whose wife is pregnant, and she's 5 months pregnant. And that little baby who nobody has seen yet, He's the most loved child in the world. I mean, his parents love him, but my brother, the grandparent, me as an uncle, we can't wait till she comes out. We're already planning her future. Like, she doesn't know any of this. And she's so loved. It's so amazing. And that's the love that God has for us. And that's the love that I encourage people to plug into and find. I found it in Jesus. I think you'll find it there. But, you know, find it at all costs. You don't want to miss that, not just in this life, but for the one to come for all eternity.
Well said. You ready for the lightning round?
Sure. Let's go. Double jeopardy, baby. Double jeopardy.
Right. What's the solution to America's drug epidemic?
Yep. I have a solution, and I really believe it would work. I believe we need to put counselors and therapists in the middle schools and high schools. And once every 2 weeks, give each kid 45 minutes of counseling. I'm not saying it'll save everybody, but what we find in drug addiction is that we're going back to the problems that you use drugs to hide from. So, and counseling is the answer to get to that. If we can counsel you in junior high and middle school and start to deal with some of these issues of low self-esteem, of feeling less than, of trauma that may have come, we're going to be a lot further ahead of the game. And I think that's it. You know, invest $100,000 in each school, two counselors, and test it in the city and come back and tell me, oh, that didn't work, Jack. I'd have a lot of respect for that. But, you know, we're in a bureaucracy, we're in, you know, political, you know, I've spoken this publicly. This, I believe, is a key. And you know, treatment centers need to be, have less people in them. They need to have 16 to 20 people maximum to be effective. I can't tell you why it doesn't scale out. I can just tell you it doesn't. And the reason a lot of treatment centers don't work, Andy, those statistics are terrible, is a lot of people who went into them didn't want to be there. They went because they were court ordered for a spouse, for a job. They weren't ready. But you know what? The heat was on them. They got caught, like when my ex-wife caught me. And so they went in to shut everybody up. But they weren't ready. They didn't want to stop. And then they heard the stuff. And then when you hear it again and again, you start to get numb to it, like your parents telling you what to do. But I think the answer is therapists in the schools early on. Get to the problem. And the only issue is, of course, is there's some parents who may not want their kids to go to therapy because they're doing stuff that they don't want exposed. But let's hope there's very few of those.
Keep in mind, there are also the older folks who have some of the same problems. Unfortunately, they're not in school any longer to get that kind of education.
Yes. And again, it's about learning about yourself. And I would encourage them, you know, to go to counseling. You know, I would tell you this, and I hope this is very encouraging. In 8 to 12 therapy hours, and I'm not a licensed therapist, I'm just a, you know, addiction guy, but I believe in 8 to 12 therapy hours, if you are legitimate about wanting to get to your core, you will have your core issues. You will have the core issue. Now, some people will need therapy all their life for trauma and abuse, and we understand that. But if you go and you want to find out, why do I do drugs? Who am I? What was I looking to conceal? In ninth grade, I was absent 91 out of 180 school days. My parents both worked. I would tell them I was sick. I was faking. Toothache, stomach. The Jewish parents loved me. Poor Jackie, you know, stay home, feel better. I was isolating myself before I ever picked up a drug. What's that about? Well, when I went to therapy, I found out. You know, I found out. And I was able, it was really no big deal. And I was able to shine a light and go, oh man, this is, I can deal with this. Glad I knew. Perspective, information, major shift. So I want to encourage people. It's not too late. And I would want to find out for myself. Find out for yourself who you are and why. Wouldn't that be the greatest value you have? And if there's something you don't like, change it. And if stuff you do like, keep it.
Decriminalizing drugs.
You know, again, it doesn't matter. That's not the problem. I mean, I'd rather see them criminalized. I'd rather not see gambling legal, this 24-hour access to the internet and drugs getting delivered to your house. But at the end of the day, you know, the availability is always there, as I said. The drugs themselves are not the problem. The alcohol itself is not the problem. It's people and their addiction, and they're trying to escape from reality and pain. The pain is real that you're trying to escape from. We want to understand it. We want to shine light on it and know what it is. It's like a doctor going in and diagnosing you. Well, just fix me, doc. Well, no. First, you got to tell me where it hurts. Then tell me the symptoms. Then I can give you the medicine.
And addicts will only go straight when they are good and ready.
Unbelievably enough, Andy, that is the bottom line. Nobody could have told, you know, people told me until I was ready, until I had hit my bottom. And I believe it's the same thing spiritually. You know, we can talk about God all we want. Until I was ready, I would have not let anybody talk to me about God. And, you know, I'm a Yankee fan. Nothing you say is going to make me a Red Sox fan or an Oriole fan. You know, so people have these set ways most of the time because of their parents and their upbringing. So most people don't even know why they believe what they believe. Why are you a Catholic? Why are you a Jew? Why do you do this? Well, my parents always did. Well, you know, find out for yourself. I mean, you know, see for yourself who you are and what you are. And you don't have to live this way. You know, there's a way out. You don't have to live this way.
Well, you've given a lot of good advice. What would you leave our audience with as something to remember?
There's hope. There's always a way out if you want one. Until you take your last breath, there's always a way out if you want one. There's hope. And, you know, when you tell people about the books are free. My Addict, Your Addict, and Addiction Recovery Handbook, free ebooks. Read them. They'll show you the ways out. There's all these different perspectives, psychologists, psychiatrists, sober homeowners, therapists, AA, every different perspective. You'll understand addiction, what it is, why it does what it does, how it works, how are the ways out. So we want you to have that for free. You know,
and Jack, how can people find out about you and about your books and all that?
Sure. JackAllenLevine.com, and Allen is A-L-A-N. It's JackAllenLevine.com. Go to the ebook store, and all the books are free. If you go to the bookstore, they charge for the hard copies, but all the ebooks are free. JackAllenLevine.com. Go to the ebook store. Both the addiction books are on there, the God books, anything you want. Take it, download it, read it. I truly believe it'll change your life. I'm doing it. You know, my life has been changed. I want to help yours. I don't want any money. I just want to help you. You know, JackAllenLevine.com. Go to the ebook store, download these books, and read it. If you're not a real reader, read My Addict, Your Addict. It's a quick read. It'll change your life. It'll give you perspective. If you
now,
want
this is your mission, but you also are a regular guy with a regular job. Is
yes.
that right?
I'm a businessman at heart. I've been involved in advertising marketing guys for years. I've been involved in solar and real estate. And, you know, I speak on overcoming addiction and on God in different places. So I love that. I love being able to just share with people what I've learned. And if it works for you, great, take it. If not, you know, share with me what you've learned.
Jack, this has been great. I learned a lot. I think that you made provided very doable solutions that don't overcomplicate the issue. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you so much for having me on the show. Blessings to you and the family, and go Boomers.
That was a fascinating story, and hopefully Jack's struggles with addictions can help others. Don't be surprised if we bring this up again at Let's Talk Food Travel Live Squared. One study estimated that the prevalence of prescription drug abuse among older Americans is as high as 11%. Now, what's caught my attention is I've heard more than once from friends and family who've had surgeries of one kind or another, you know, casually tell me how much that pain-killing pill that they were taking put them into some kind of a tranquil awakening like never before. Meanwhile, Mimi gave us a little hint at what she is doing in the kitchen. Let's get back and check it out.
Hi, I'm back. We're gonna cook the prawns first. Let's do it with not a lot of. It takes approximately 6 minutes to cook this. You just cook 3 minutes from each side, and it should be okay. There you go. Ooh, that's so good. I'll put this one here. Alrighty, we're gonna. So my spinach is all cut up. My tomatoes, garlic. Look at that. Before I go, I'm gonna show you how you need the prawns to be like nice color like this. They're not opaque anymore. All right, I'll talk to you later.
Thanks, Mimi. Looking good. In our series, Traveling the Northern Gulf Islands of Canada and part of the Comox Valley Regional District of British Columbia, we ferry over to Denman Island. It is part of the Islands Trust, is home to a small community of about 1,500 people year-round.
Traveling by ferry becomes a way of life throughout the coastal British Columbia area. BC Ferries are one of the largest ferry operators in the world. They provide short hops to the picturesque Gulf Islands, sailing from both Vancouver Island and the communities along the Sunshine Coast, northwest of Vancouver, and north to BC's magnificent Discovery Coast and the Inside Passage. Today, we arrive at the terminal at Buckley Bay on Vancouver Island. Now, a lesson I want to impart on you that I learned the hard way is to be at your ferry terminal more than a few minutes ahead of time. I was there just about a minute before my ferry was going to leave. There was a car ahead of me at the ticket terminal. That car got on, but I didn't. I was a little late. Oh well. An oh well attitude becomes part of life for travelers because schedules and long waits are not uncommon. That's quickly forgotten, though, with the beautifully clear skies of spring, summer, and fall. It's a gorgeous trip. The island is especially popular among tourists on motorcycles. The Denman General Store and the Denman Island Community Hall have been the hub of island life since their construction in 1908 and 1912, respectively. And these buildings and the century-old Denman Guest House on Denman Road anchor what is known, and tongue-in-cheek, as Downtown Denman or Denman Village. There is also the Dora Drinkwater Volunteer Library, a community school, an Anglican church, and the Arts Center. There's also a hardware store, craft store, and books and coffee shops. And around the corner at Piercy Road is the Denman Island Health Center. A number of potters, weavers, and painters have made Denman Island their home for decades.
It was really nice there. Next week, we'll be in for a surprise. And talk about surprises, let's see what Mimi has put together.
I'm back. Now the prawns, look at the beautiful color. It's already, you know. Now I'm gonna go in with my tomatoes in the same pan. My garlic, lots of garlic, good for you. And then a little salt, a little pepper, and then stir. Yeah. It's like you don't cook them too much, just to check the raw, the raw taste of garlic, and you'll be just fine because it has olive oil. And then I'm gonna put some lemon juice also. So you keep stirring because you do not want to burn that garlic. When you stir it like this, it's that. All right. And this is very, very Mediterranean. You cannot go wrong with this. It's delicious and light. So see, now I go in with my spinach that I cut up. You see that? So you just turn it, toss it just a little bit. Doesn't need a lot of cooking. You just want it wilted like that. All right, a little dill, and you're done. Now, we are going to plate it in a, takes 1 second. Oh, well, I'm lying, not a second, but doesn't take a long time. So here goes, surprise. You serve it with hummus. So you go, you make hummus, homemade hummus. It's very easy. One day I'm gonna make you hummus. I'll show you how to make it. You just spread this in the bottom of a plate like that, as you like to make it. All right. Try to put everything in there. Right. Okay. And then you take your spinach and tomato like that. Oh, wow. Smells so good. Take care of all of it, because you're going to have a nice nice lunch or dinner. So, okay. Get all of it here. All right. Then, put your nice prawns on top. As many as you like. Depends. We are just two people, so we're gonna maybe have five each. So, like that. Mm-hmm. Voila. Voila. Nice. Look at that. So now, you remember when I said don't put a lot of salt? It's because if you like feta cheese, you put some. If you don't. Just put a little bit in the, like this, in the border of the plate, because you don't want it to get too salty. Right? And then I made a little yogurt, spicy yogurt sauce that you can drizzle on top of the prawns. Ooh. Ah. So I made it spicy with Calabrian chilies. Or you can use whatever spicy sauce you like. Just yogurt, garlic, lemon juice. And voila, you have a wonderful sauce. Bon appetit. You can add some mint. Look at that. Fresh mint. Beautiful lunch. All protein. And it's delicious also. I'll see you next time.
Thank you, Mimi. That was great. I can't wait to taste it. And thank you so much for tuning in to Let's Talk Food Travel Live Squared. If you enjoyed this episode or you learned something new, I want to tell you, you know, three ways that you can support the show and keep Let's Talk Food Travel Live Squared going. You know, number one, get yourself subscribed. Every week, I am bringing on the influencers and the people who can teach you something or have something interesting to share. So take a moment to hit that subscribe button. And number two, this is the ultimate way to support Let's Talk Food Travel Live Squared, and it takes less than a minute. You can write something, you know, something short and sweet like, I love the show, it has changed your life, or something you learned from it, you know. I'm not exaggerating that I read reviews every day, and every single one, whether short or long, it really means everything to me. The more reviews means the higher we rank on all those algorithms, which means bigger guests. So take a minute to leave a review. And then three, share the show with your friends. Just hit that share button. I'm eternally grateful. Thank you so much for supporting this show. And I will see you again next Tuesday for another episode of Let's Talk Food Travel Live Squared.